Born into one of the many oppressed human settlements of the Death World Barbarus, Groom Thrail was only a boy when Mortarion eventually discovered the poison-free valleys populated with his kin. When the Death Lord began making the necessary preparations to overthrow the alien warlocks who had preyed upon them, Groom was eager to impress the savior of his people. He tirelessly trained in the arts of war, soaking up every morsel of information and advice available to him, determined to do his utmost to aid in the impending onslaught that would eradicate the mist-shrouded mountain citadels beyond recall. He became adept with the blade, especially the traditional Barbarusian greatsword, and exhibited extraordinary flair when it came to single combat, quickly rising to the position by Mortarion's side as champion. When the Emperor eventually found the 14th Primarch, and the last of the Xenos tyrants was dispatched, Groom was a prime candidate for the complicated and risky processes required to become a posthuman. He maintained the position as Mortarion's blade, representing the Death Guard throughout the Great Crusade in ceremonial combat that became a tradition between legions campaigning together. Famously, he paired with Duriel of the Blood Angels in a paired duel aboard the World Eater's flagship, the Conqueror, some 50 years before the Heresy. Together, Groom and Duriel remained undefeated, their styles and favored weaponry complementing each other superbly. The brotherhood that was established during this time across such different legions was rare, and the source of Groom's singular sorrow when Mortarion threw his lot in with the Moormaster and the Legion was pitted against Legion.
Hello everyone, and welcome to Project Retrospective number 5, where we'll take a closer look at Groom Thrail, who's a Legion champion of the 14th Legion, Death Guard. Now this model actually has quite a nice history behind it, and has a real-world sort of rivalry between myself and Miles of Little Legend Studios, and many of you will know that we both played a game against each other on the 30K channel some time ago, about a year and a half ago, where his gorgeous looking Blood Angels were pitted against my grimy 14th Legion in a game that I totally fluffed and got utterly annihilated in. However, we both made a special effort to make these two characters. So he had Duriel of the 9th Legion Blood Angels, and I had Groon of the 14th Legion. So a bit of history behind the characters themselves that Mars and I worked on, just to get a little bit more of a background rather than just having a pitted battle against each other. And this is where they faced off against each other for the first time since their very famous duels together in the fighting pits of the World Eaters. So a bit of treachery, heresy, some broken bonds and bromance shattered, laying on the floor in pieces. So today I wanted to go through this chap and the parts used. I've obviously gone through his little background there that I wrote as a prelude to this game with Miles. So he had quite a bit of hype about the game. So a bit of background there for this chap, outlining how he became Mortarion's chosen man, chosen champion, and then I'll go through the bits now and a few of the processes used for the conversion of the model. And obviously there is many of you sort of old hammer people may or may not recognize the influence for this model, which was an old plague marine with a power fist, a pointy power fist. So anyway, better cut to the chase. So I'll start bottom up, as it were. So the base itself, I made using a variety of different things. So had textured plasticards, this diamond tread plate plasticard, which can be easily found online, but I believe mine was bought through Green Stuff World. Okay. The same with the little snaking cables there. That cabling was made with the tentacle roller, which I mentioned as well in yesterday's video. Now I might as well mention it now. The pipe connecting his gorget to his back is also made using that tool. Okay, so you can make all sorts of different gauges and sizes with it. It's well worth having, certainly if you're a mechanicum player. But even if you wanted to have a bit of extra stuff for embellishment and bases and cabling and tubing on your models, okay. So the raised section that his left fitter's on is just merely cork, and you sort of seal that up using diluted PVA glue just to make sure that it doesn't soak up an awful lot of paint. And then there's a little nodule there, like a little plug, the male part of a plug. You know, God knows where this guy's fighting, whether it's a gantry or something along those lines, some massive hangar bay or something like that. But that is from a Mechanicum, just a ordinary Skitarii backpack. So the legs, like the character yesterday, they're made from the Death Shroud legs, okay, where I would have elongated them. And you can see at the back there, you've got those overlapping armor plates that I've just popped in just to make it look a little bit more like Mark III rather than Tartaros armor. Obviously the groin plate there as well is part of that kit. The body, so this actually took a little bit of work. So I needed to do quite a lot of cutting and pasting, and I used I believe it's actually a Plague Champion from the 40k kit that has the little sassy Nurgling. I think it's very famous for that. And I had to attach that to a back section that would work with the legs. So I think the entire back part of the body there is actually sculpted from scratch, apart from the collar, which I think I transplanted from another kit. But that is from the Death Guard Champion. And I've just taken the fine cast Space Marine Terminator Chaplain, I should say. I took one of his shoulder pads has this winged angel detail. Now, I thought, okay, a Legion Champion, it's a fairly ceremonial role. Obviously, they are beasts in combat. Certainly with this whack, this whack setup I've got with a Power Fist and a Paragon Blade. But this would be surely the best time of any to have a bit more bling on a model of the 14th Legion, who are obviously traditionally very, very dour and plain and just battle damaged with very little ostentation on them. So I thought, let's bling this guy up a bit, especially considering he was besties with Duriel of a Legion that are famed for their ostentation and sort of use of icons and filigree and all this sort of fine detail on their armor. It's artistry, essentially, worked into their very functional power armor. So I used a Dremel rotary tool, in actual fact, it's Maplin rotary tool, RIP Maplin, to very, very carefully remove the volume of resin, that fine cast, behind this angel, and I sort of slapped it on that body there, just to give him a bit of detailing. Okay. Likewise, the roundels there are also from the Death Shroud kit, so I've just very gently cut those off of the Tartaros shoulder pads, and given him more of a knightly feel. And very nice to sort of pin in with the cloak that I'll go into detail into later. Okay, so the backpack, as well as the right arm, the sword arm, and both shoulder pads are all from the 40k Death Guard models, the Plague Marines. The backpack, I think, is actually also from the Sassy Nurgling Champion. And the shoulder pads, I think you get one in the box of seven Plague Marines. So I was able to source two just to get that sort of very morbid skull look all over the model, as it's obviously a Legion that aren't necessarily obsessed with death, but a lot of reaping and death and a very nasty background growing up on the plague world of Barbarus. So death world, perhaps, even. I've just taken one of the standard Mark III resin Legion shoulder pads, and again, similarly to the belly detail, I've Dremeled off the detailing behind it and stuck that on his left shoulder pad, just to obviously give more of a feeling, or like more of a representation of his Legion. So he's got also on his right van brace, he's got the same Legion symbol. Okay, the Power Fist is from the Grave Warden set, okay? Again, pretty functional, pretty beefy, pretty beat up, okay? Didn't need to have anything too detailed for him here. And I've just heated that up to give him more of a pointing finger there. So he's issuing, like, sort of shouting out a challenge to a rival champion or character. So he just wants to throw down, basically. He's like, "You there! Let us fight! Pit against each other in combat!" Or something to that effect. So, points if you can tell where the head is from. Okay, this is actually Ezekiel Abaddon's head, where I've filled in the hole at the top where his top knot would usually fit, and I've taken some detailing. I've basically removed a large section of the scalp and filled it in with a smooth plate of green stuff there, just to show that he's obviously taken quite a big injury to the head there and has needed to have some surgery. So one of the apothecaries grafting this adamantium plate onto his skull, just so he can get back to the front line as soon as possible. Okay, just very quickly mention the scabbard of the sword is also from the sword itself, sorry, and the scabbard, hadn't even mentioned that before. It's a Nighthaunt, so an Age of Sigmar Nighthaunt character called the Lord of Executions, I believe. So it's this skeleton dude on a skeleton horse, and I just thought, again, a little bit more embellishment and detail there, a bit of ostentation in the blade as well. So the Barbarusian greatsword, and I think it ties in very, very nicely with the Legion that the scabbard has an hourglass detailing. So some of you will know from the decal sheets from Forge World, there's an awful lot of hourglass detailing on there that you can stick on your models just to add a bit more detail and tie them into a particular formation. Okay. Now the major sculpting work here, other than obviously the body, which is mainly hidden, the back of the body, there's obviously his cloak, okay, the back of the legs, any of the piping there, soft armor, okay, so his power fist arm. Now, ordinarily, since I painted this chap, I got chatting with Prometheus, who again mentioned in the last video. Please check out his work if you haven't already, but X2 painting, and he said, really, in order to boost that contrast of the model, just try your best to paint soft armor in sort of like a black, like a matte black. So I'll probably go back to this guy at some point and do that, just to up that contrast. Again, contrast is super important for making models look good. But the soft armor around his neck, as well as the cloak, they are all sculpted, okay, by hand. So now, quite at odds with the usual way I will sculpt cloaks, this one is fairly two-dimensional, okay? Now, the reason being for this is that obviously I wanted to make sure that he had this scabbard underneath and it wasn't lost under some mountain of cloth, basically. So obviously trying to make it as realistic as possible with tattered edges, everything along those lines, and I would have achieved the tattered edges and the holes in there by allowing the cloak to cure first and then making these holes with tools and essentially adding some green stuff just and making it look raggedy and unfinished and sort of ripped and torn before it dried, basically. And I've just slapped a Legion icon on the top there, but it would have been very difficult to create a nice sort of undulating cloak with the scabbard in addition. But there we go. So that's the sort of major breakdown of the model. Okay. So I guess it's worth commenting that I'm very pleased with how this turned out. Obviously, my painting has advanced since then, but I will leave this guy as like I said, I might add a few additional details there. A few tricks that I've picked up since, okay, just to add some very small scratches to the armor and have those highlighted, but also a bit more mottling on the armor as well, and painting obviously that soft armor in the black color in addition. So obviously wanted to give this guy a very weathered feel. I think I probably used Nilek Oxide a little bit too much here, okay? But I recently picked up, I think, I'm trying to remember who it was, and I think it was Pete of Uplander, okay, again, very famous for his gorgeous Space Wolves, okay, or Vilka Fenrika, is very much into the fluff. But he, I think he used Sotek Green just to water down, or just to dull down the Nilek a bit. So Nilek Oxide, I've learned how to use it a lot better since this model, but it is one of those things that you really should use very, very gradually. So use it very, very diluted and multiple layers until you get the sort of taste to taste, or as sort of rusty or oxidized as you want. I don't think this is particularly bad, but I think that it could definitely be dialed down a little bit. Okay, you may disagree, but I think that it's one of those technical paints that should be used very sparingly, okay, and realistically. Again, he's going to be pretty, you know, maybe not keep such great care of his armor, but he's still a Legion champion, so he needs to get his thralls to do bits and bobs as and when. So this guy's great fun to use. Unfortunately, every game that I've used him in, I've just been absolutely fluffed. So ordinarily, I'd run him with my Weapon Master vets, okay, who are equipped either with Power Mauls or, which obviously works extremely well with the Reaping, minus one of your enemy's toughness with Rad Grenades in the first round of combat. So Strength 6 versus Toughness 3, you are doing a lot of damage to even Marines, okay? Or if I'm looking to open some Terminators up, I'll run them with those Power Axes. Again, it does get quite pricey, but this guy alongside Scourge, who is my Legion Herald, who I should be doing a video for in the near future, they run as a dream team with these veterans. So I definitely need to get my my Mark IIb Land Raider finished and painted so I can get my veterans just running out of that into the enemy and causing, one would hope, an awful lot of damage as they go. So again, so a lot of work that could be done to improve this guy. He ended up winning a Warhammer sort of Forge World painting competition. I think they were looking for champions or characters along that sort of ilk, fighters, duelists potentially. And I think that this won their competition at the beginning of last year, so 2019. I was extremely pleased with that. So I'd really pushed myself at the time with this model, and I was very happy with how things like the flesh turned out, the armor, again, just really getting to grips with the airbrush. All of us will always be showing constant improvement, but at the time this was sort of a bit of a benchmark for me, so I was particularly proud with that. But there we go. So I hope you've enjoyed this video, and again, please, I really love you guys giving feedback and comments below. Really important to me to know that I'm hitting the mark with these videos and that you're enjoying the content, okay, as the people who are watching the videos. I'll try and find some suitable music on this as well, see if I can get some close-ups and, like yesterday's video, overlay those over the model, over the video itself. And I think the other feedback that I received, I obviously need to get a little bit more confident behind the mic, behind the camera. So it's an awful lot of umming and erring, so apologies if that does put you off, but I am trying my best. I will obviously try to make sure that is a minimized thing in future videos, okay? So, yeah, umming and erring still. Great, good video stuff here. Anyway, really really glad to show you this scarf to you today, and stay tuned for some more awesome content. Cheerio, or I should say, death to the false emperor!